TCP isn't perfect either. The connection-making mechanism and the disconnection is designed to be failure-resistant, but it wasn't designed to be resistant to attacks. We won't go over all possible attacks here, but only one: SYN flooding denial of service attack. Denial of service, or DOS attacks, are based on sending multiple requests to the server. Each request eats resources such as computing, memory, or both. If the attacker can send enough requests to the server, it won't have enough resources to deal with legitimate requests, and the service it provides will be hurt. Still not clear? Let's conduct an experiment. Ask a friend a question and don't wait for a response. Ask him again and again and again. At some stage, he'll start being nervous or upset. If at the same time another person, not you, asks him a question, they probably won't get an answer because the friend is dealing with your bullying. We rendered him unable to provide service. So what is DDoS? It's just a distributed denial of service attack. What does that mean? Get a few friends together and ask someone the same question or questions. In a SYN flooding attack, the attacker sends multiple SYN requests, which are requests to open connection to the server, hoping to leave it with no resources for legitimate requests. We'll soon see how the attack works, but first, let's analyze a case of an attempt to create a connection over a very noisy channel. How would the connection creating process function over a noisy channel? A noisy channel can be one that creates errors or packet drops at high rates. First, the sender will send a SYN request. For the sake of discussion, let's assume the request successfully arrived, but because the channel is noisy, the SYN ACK message the server sends doesn't reach its destination. The client waits until a timeout occurs. Let's say waiting time is 3 seconds, and he sends another SYN request. 3 seconds aren't mandatory. It's possible that in different implementations, times will be different. But let's assume there is a set time that has to be taken into account. Let's go back to our example. The second time a SYN request is sent, it also arrives to its destination, but the SYN plus ACK messages the server sends do not. Again, the client waits for a timeout, but since there already was another timeout, the client has to increase the waiting time. And let's say doubles it. So now it's 6 seconds. Why? Because if 3 wasn't enough, maybe it should wait longer. Next time, the client will wait 12 seconds for a timeout. It'll double the value until it reaches a maximum value of 64 seconds. And if no confirmation arrives from the server, the client abandons the request and notifies the app that the server cannot be reached. Does the time increase have to be exponential? Not necessarily. But in our example, we'll do it like that. Generally, the waiting time has to go up. Let's get back to our case. We'll wait for 3 plus 6 plus 12 seconds, etc., which is 157 seconds, in which we'll send 6 SYN requests. But we need to remember what the server is doing. The server allocates memory for handling each request. The server has to remember to match the ACK message it receives from the client to the SYN request it received in the past. Among other things, it needs to store details of the SYN request and allocate memory for that. If some time passed and no ACK message was found for a particular SYN request, the server assumes that due to an error, this SYN request won't be answered by the client, and it frees up the allocated memory. In our case, for 157 seconds, the server allocated ROM for 6 SYN requests. The SYN attack idea is simple. Since the server allocates memory space to each SYN request because it prepares resources for the new connection, the attacker will flood the server with multiple SYN requests that will not be finally approved, which is the third part of the handshake. Since the SYN requests weren't confirmed, the server can't free up the memory allocated to the SYN request. Because it takes some time to free up memory from the first request, the server will allocate more and more memory until it exhausts available memory. So far, we have described the attack theoretically. But is the attack practical? How many requests can the attacker send over a time period of 157 seconds until the server starts freeing the memory it allocated? Will these requests consume enough memory for the server to crash? Let's look at an example. We'll try to see how much memory the server will consume from sending SYN requests from one machine the attacker has. The total of all memory the server will need due to the attack will be the amount of memory allocated to the connections times the number of SYN requests sent over 157 seconds. Let's assume the amount of memory supporting one SYN request is X kilobytes. We'll also assume that the attacker utilizes all the bandwidth they have to send SYN requests and that the bandwidth they have is equal to Y megabytes divided by seconds. The amount of memory is the amount of information sent over 157 seconds times the amount of memory each connection needs from the server. If the attacker constantly sends SYN requests, then 157 seconds times bandwidth divided by the SYN requests equals the number of messages sent. If we multiply this amount by X, we'll know how much memory we're reserving. Let's assume that X can be 20 kilobytes, and the number of messages at a slow rate can be a very large amount of messages. We understand we can quickly reach a situation where dozens or hundreds of gigs are reserved for non-existent connections. Even if the attacker is afraid that the server will have enough memory, they can attack from a small number of machines and crash the server. How can we protect ourselves against the attack? A first solution to the SYN attack problem is simple. Limit the number of SYN requests that can come from a single IP. In this diagram, the number of open SYN requests from the same IP is limited to 3. So the first 3 requests will be answered by the server, but it will ignore the rest, meaning that it won't allocate memory for them. This way, it will never reach a crash state due to memory use. Did this solve the SYN attack problem? It turns out we made it more difficult, but didn't eliminate the problem. Remember that the attacker can write a fake IP origin in the IP address title. Remember we talked about that in the first chapter, IP spoofing, in every request they send? Additionally, the attacker can change the fake IP in every request they send and thus trick the server defenses. So how can we still defend the server from a SYN attack? So long as TCP allocates memory upon reception of a SYN request, it will be vulnerable to a SYN attack. If we reduce the memory amount to a minimum, we'll increase the number of computers needed to cooperate in the attack for the required bandwidth, but we won't prevent the attack. The best way to prevent the attack is to prevent memory allocation in the SYN stage and to allot memory for the connection only when the ACK arrives from the client. How can we do that? How can we overcome the need to save information in the SYN stage? First, let's try to understand why we need to allocate memory in the SYN stage. Remember that the server can receive multiple SYN requests. When the server receives an ACK message, it must find which SYN request is connected to the ACK message it received to be able to create a connection, with which client it is now in a state of establish. What information is relevant to coordinate? Information such as the IP and the client's port, the IP and the server's port, and the serial number of the next byte for client and server, the time at which the SYN request arrived, and other parameters. How can we avoid saving all this information? We'll try to encode it into the information the server sends the client, and when the client responds to the server, instead of saving the data on the server, we'll save it in the messages exchanged between client and server. What options do we have for encoding the information inside the TCP traffic between client and server? One way is to use the Options field. The server can route the information into the Options field in the TCP header. During the ACK, the client will copy the information into the Options field. This way, the server can receive the information it needs without saving it on its end. In theory, we solved the problem. But what will we do if the client has a different version of TCP that doesn't support this solution? The client won't return the Options field with the information the server needs, and the server won't be able to create the connection for the client. Is there another way? If we summarize the discussion so far, we want to plant information in the messages between client and server so that we can match the SYN request with the ACK message received later. We already talked about ways to save sessions, right? The attempt to save in the Options field failed because it required the cooperation of the client, and that isn't necessarily possible. Can the server send the information to the client in a transparent way? The answer is yes, if it can affect the value of one of the fields in the TCP header. But the header fields are short and don't include enough bytes to code all user data to identify SYN requests. Can we overcome this issue? Yes, if we look. The information details on the connection, such as the client's port number and their IP, can be taken from the ACK message. We want to match the SYN request to the ACK message. Which field would the server use? The SecNum field, which is 32 bytes long, with a value that can be any number. We'll create a function that will take all the relevant information, including origin and destination address, port time signature, origin and destination, and code it into a 32-byte-long number to prevent the attacker from guessing it. We'll send it in the server's SecNum field in the SYN plus ACK message, which is sent to the client after receiving the SYN request from the client. This value is called a SYN cookie. When receiving the message, the client adds 1 to the SecNum value they got from the server and put it in the Acknowledgement SecNum field. The server will get the value, deduce 1, and calculate the expected function value based on the parameters it gets and compare the value it gave with the value the client sent. If the value doesn't match, the request is not approved, and no memory will be allocated to it.